Excellent. Is there a secret life in there? Is something we should know about?
Yeah. Oh, I'm from Arizona, so yeah, it's all gonna be it's all gonna come out.
You escaped Arizona.
Yeah. Why not?
And you're in show business, so you can't really be that Arizonan.
Well, I mean, I lived there till I was like 30. Huh. So, I mean, I'm pretty... And look, and I got, like, the worst skin. I have, like, very fair skin. She has very fair skin, too. But, like, I burned... my childhood was... I was just sunburned nonstop. I will probably get skin cancer at some point in my life because of my stupid decisions as a child.
So you were 30.
Yeah, until I was 30. Well, I mean, I kind of stopped. I realized...
Which is a child still for some people.
Yeah, well, I'm very immature. But I had, like... I would put sunscreen on maybe when I... was like 12. That's when I started wearing sunscreen, but until then I was constantly peeling. It was so disgusting.
It's a lovely story.
Yeah.
It's a
lovely image.
I did. There was a children's TV show called Wallace and Ladmo in Arizona. Mm-hmm. And it was kind of like you know Bozo the Clown on WGN and all that. It's kind of like that sort of thing. And this thing was on for like 50 years, I want to say. It was on forever, but it was just local. And they'd have all these kids come on and everything, and I got to go on with my family. Mm-hmm. And I gotta find the tape. I'm literally sitting there, beet red, because I'd been swimming the day before, and like my hair's a little green from the chlorine of the pool, and like Wallace and Ladmo are like interviewing me and everything, and I'm just sitting like this 8-year-old kid just like talking to them, and I looked so stupid. I gotta find that tape.
It sounds like a good one.
Yeah, it was fun. Yeah.
Self-humiliation is a beautiful thing.
And then Wallace, I don't wanna say, well, yeah, I think he passed away, but he was like hitting on my sister, and she was like,
how old was your sister?
I don't want to say, but she, you know.
Was she of age, at least? No.
I don't want to say, but he was like, so he had her up, and he's like, so, Samantha. Like, it was just like, like, you look at it now, you're like, oh, I know what he's doing. But, like, to a kid, you're like, oh, he likes my sister. He's this great.
Nothing wrong with that.
So is this what inspired you to be an actor?
Yeah. I was like, the moment I was on Wallace and Ladmo, I was hooked.
Were you interested at all at that point when you were on, or were you just
I think so. I think I did a lot of, like, I goofed around a lot. I had a fun childhood. My mom was always pulling pranks on her kids, and you know, we'd put on plays, and she would direct us and do different things. And I don't think she's not in the entertainment industry. She didn't have a background in theater or any of that, but that's kind of where I got my taste. I mean, she would wake us up in the morning singing Broadway show tunes, and like I was just like immersed in it. And so it took a while. It took till I was, you know, probably 30 before I moved to LA and realized this is what I'm going to do. But it was always kind of inside of me, just sitting there watching, thinking, oh, I'd love to do that. I want to do that, you know, but never really pulling the trigger.
So did you act in Arizona? Or wait till you got here?
Yeah, when I was in Arizona, I did a couple plays, you know, local productions and stuff like that. But, you know, it, as fun and as good of a stepping stone as that community and that scene is, like, I mean, there's nothing like coming to Los Angeles or even a place like New York, or if you're going to do theater, Houston, Chicago. But you really have to, you kind of got, I had to get out of that environment because it just, I was going to hit that ceiling right away, you know.
Mm-hmm. Arizona's always in a movie, a Neil Simon movie, where they... You know, the guy who's not making it as an actor anymore goes to do dinner theater.
Right.
It's always like an Arizona dinner theater.
I did dinner theater.
Or Wisconsin or something.
Yeah, I did like a dinner theater fundraiser thing. And I think that was like my first production. I don't remember what it was called, but, you know, it was one of those murder mystery things. And it was set up like a press conference. And I was like the cameraman who was going to like film everyone. And I had no lines and I wasn't supposed to like, I was really just supposed to be in the background. And I pretty much like just improvised and took over the show, and like everyone was like, my favorite character was the cameraman, and like the director's getting pissed off at me and everything because I was like kind of hogging the spotlight from the murder, you know. That's what are you gonna do?
So is that still how it works?
Yes.
So I guess I'm guessing you're not from Arizona.
I'm not. I'm from Minnesota.
Oh, see, there you go.
Yeah, Minneapolis. Well,
Minnesota has like a big contingent out in Los Angeles.
We do, and in New York as well. A lot of people I grew up with went out east, and I did preliminary. I went to NYU and then came to LA.
Because you wanted to make movies or because it was warmer?
Yeah, I think both. I think I had enough friends saying you should go out and see what Los Angeles is like. I grew up in the theater, so New York was it for me. But I also didn't want to be a starving artist my whole life. And so I thought, oh, you can actually make a commercial and make so much money by working one day or one afternoon and then having it continually air. And I thought, this is great. So then I decided to come out here.
So did you have success in that? Were you?
Commercially, yes. It was great. And, you know, I supplemented my income doing that. But in terms of theatrical, no, it was very sort of very slow going, way more than I thought it would be, which is, was a nice reality check.
So were you playing teenage girls and young mothers or just teenage girls? Or?
Yes.
I thought that question was directed at me. I'm sorry. Yeah,
yes.
I didn't. Okay.
And your sister, Samantha.
In New York, they don't want to age you necessarily. You just go in and do your thing. And in Los Angeles, they're very quick to sort of pigeonhole you and tell you, this is what you can do and this is what you can't do, which was sort of, I'd never experienced that before. So it was interesting. But, you know.
Interesting and frustrating or just interesting?
I'm a big believer in like playing the game, and you just sort of see the landscape and then decide how you can work it to your own benefit, because we're all out here in sort of a blank slate, and it's up to you to do with that what you will, and with what you will. So whatever people wanted to see me as was fine, and I would just do my thing. I didn't really care too much.
And so how did you decide you were going to be a writer-director?
Because I wasn't working, and I'm very, I have zero patience. I'm the most impatient person I know, which is annoying to a lot of people. But I couldn't sit still, so I just...
Are you confirming this, or are you denying it?
I don't confirm or deny it. I mean, we're all impatient, I think. If you're living in Los Angeles, I mean, even I talked to a guy the other day. He'd been here, like, maybe 6 months, and he was pissed off he wasn't on a TV show yet. And I was like, it takes time.
Yeah.
Like, you don't know anybody yet. Like, chill out. So, I mean, and he was a great guy, but, I mean, there's a level of impatience that we all have. So, I'm not going to, you know, confirm or deny, and, I mean, whatever.
So, you're impatient, and you...
So, I'm impatient, and we had... I wanted to make a little short, and I got my friend Adam to write and direct it, and I asked Josh to be in it, and we had met in an acting class, and I thought he was fantastic. And so he agreed to do that, and we made it, and we had so much fun. And then, you know, the next day, I grew impatient and thought, okay, I need to do something else. And my boyfriend said, well, why don't you just do this and extend it by 21 days or however long it takes to shoot a film, a feature. And he introduced me to the world of no-budget filmmaking and said, sure, you can make it for however much you have in your bank account. So I said, okay, great.
So did he have a, does he have a history of doing it, or is he just...
No, not at all. He
saw it on a TV somewhere?
Yeah, exactly. He picked up a book at Barnes & Noble, How to Make a Feature Film.
In 21 days or less.
Yeah.
It was the last book at Barnes &
yeah.
Noble.
Book? What
it was
book?
In the clearance section. No, he comes from the studio world and sort of developing studio films, which is couldn't be more different than independent work. But he introduced it to me gradually, and I started familiarizing myself with Ed Burns, the Duplass brothers, Lena Dunham, Britt Marlin. And I actually had a few people in my NYU class who went and did this, Daryl Ween and Zoe Lister-Jones, and they had success with it. So I thought, oh, I can do that. And so I just set out to write what I know, and I wrote it specifically for the people I wanted to be in it and who I believed in, and that was tremendously helpful. Because I sort of already heard their voice in my head, and it just sort of came out. And then, of course, I'd run things by Josh and get his input, and my boyfriend Lance as well, and a few mentors I have in the business, and that really helped.
The great thing about Katharine is, like, you know, not she's not just a great actress and a really great director, and she wrote this amazing script, but she's an amazing producer. She's able to pull everything together and get things done when it seems like it could be impossible. I mean, when you're working with such a small budget, I mean, look, we would love, like, $1 million is still not a lot of money when you're making a movie. We would have killed to have $1 million, you know? Mm-hmm. But she was still able to make things happen, and that's, I think, like, her biggest asset no matter what moving forward, whether she continues to direct, continues to act, write, whatever, is that she just is able to get things done. And I think just, I mean, there's so many people that just sit there inactive and wait and go, I just need this thing to happen. If someone does this for me, then I can do this. Where she's not going to wait. She's just like, I'm going to go make a movie. And it's inspiring. It's great. I told her that when she first came up with the idea, like after we shot the short, I was like, I'm on board. Like, this is exactly the thing that I want to do. You know, I made her do all the work and then I just showed up. But no, but she, you know, every step of the way, she was like, what about this? What about that? I mean, she was so like in it instead of phoning it in, mm-hmm. which I feel like a lot of artists do. You know, actors do when they try and create their own work, they start to realize how hard it actually is and they give up. And I think, I don't even think you realize how hard it still can be or can continue to be.
Yeah.
Yet you're not giving up with it. And that's like inspiring for me. And I know for a lot of other people.
So are the three different hats, different hats for you, or is it all kind of blur together? I guess four different hats probably as producer.
I just knew every day was sort of like, I knew no one else is going to do any of the jobs for me. So I just, it was just a given that whether it's buying toilet paper, you know, texting him, here's your parking info, or, you know, making sure the DP has everything he needs, whatever it was, I just didn't question it. Like, oh, this isn't my job to get Febreze for the, you know, toilet paper in the, you know, grungy bar that we're shooting in today. Mm. Whatever it was, it was just, I took it on as my job.
So as a writer, though, did you give yourself 6 months to write the script before you thought about funding it, thought about whatever, or is it all kind of a ongoing process?
Well, like I said, I'm very impatient. So I tried to knock out the script in like 2 weeks. And then I spent about a little under 6 months fine-tuning it and sharing it with Josh and people whose opinion I respected. And then we very quickly, I wanted to make it. And in the process of, I think the script had already been written and we were sort of, we had a window of when we wanted to shoot it. And then Josh got this amazing opportunity and so well deserved. And he got on.
Being in your movie.
Yes, of course. my film. And then the secondary opportunity for him, which is very small and no one's heard of it, but a great TV show. And so then a new set of challenges came on board, and it was all good things, but it was how do we still get this shot and get this made, which is something that we wanted to do, and accommodate all the stuff that he was, the new obligations he had.
So you shot it in Atlanta, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, no. we shot it here in Los Angeles and in Palm Springs. We just shot it very quickly and efficiently and tried to figure out, and Josh was very kind to give us the very little free time that he had.
So as a writer, are you in it? I mean, are you writing a blueprint or are you writing, is that the script? Is that a play where everything, you're going to stick to it exactly as it is? What is your position as a writer?
I would say I wrote out everything, and what I had help with is the stand-up sections. Mm-hmm. And we put funny people that Josh knew and that were recommended to me and that I knew, and we always tried to do a couple takes where we said, go at it and bring your own material to it. Mm-hmm. So does that answer your question?
But in the other scene, I mean, are you committed to every line being said the way you wrote it, or
no,
kind of improvised a little bit, or?
No, I think we definitely had freedom to kind of make it our own, but there were a couple times where maybe we started to get off topic or off track with in terms of what the point of the scene is. And I think that's kind of the trouble you get when you let people improvise. And I hesitate to say that word because I know we're not supposed to say that word in this business when you're shooting a written word. But you know, we would kind of have fun with it. And there were a couple times where it's like, okay, we went too far. We got to bring it back because this is actually the point of the scene. This is the thing that we need to focus on. And all this stuff is hilarious, but we can't use it. And we're just, you know, wasting time. And I was guilty of that a lot because I'll just get on a tangent and keep talking. And then she starts getting impatient. And then, no.
but it made it fun. I mean, look, making a movie for the money we had, which was next to nothing, is extremely stressful. I'm not going to sugarcoat it at all, and it's stressful for everyone. So but you have to remember at any point, let's try to seize an opportunity to have fun. And those were one of the best days, I thought, was the day we shot with the therapist, because he was such an asset and so great, and it was just fun. And it was nice to have a day like that where we could have fun and not be so serious within the text. And the only thing that makes it challenging is then when you get to editing and you have all this footage to sift through, and that scene might have take longer to cut than other scenes, but it was a welcomed, you know, extra few hours to really sift through, because it only makes the film better.
Well, and a lot of times too, when you're, you know, shooting stuff where people are improvising, you want to try and get as many cameras as possible rolling at once so you can capture everything. And we were just using one camera in that take. But the cool thing, David Storrs, who plays the therapist,
Amazing.
Oh, I thought you were shaking your head. I'm like, that's not, I thought that was him.
Yes.
I mean, I'd seen him before in some things and I was like, this guy's hilarious. So then when she told me who had been hired for the therapist, I'm like, this guy's great. Like, I was so excited for it. And he like raised the bar. He brought it even more. But then the challenge becomes with one camera is remembering what you improvised, remembering what you were doing. But he's so good that he was able to go back and hit the things that we needed to for when the camera's pointed on us so that we could all pick it up and have the same stuff. I mean, everyone was really bringing their A game in this because, you know, if there was a weak link anywhere in the film, the whole film would drop. Mm-hmm. And that was really cool to get people like David, Jim O'Hare, Fortune Feimster to come in and just really make the film great.
Yeah.
So were you intimidated at all by being an actor for a director who you knew so well? For act directing yourself.
Oh, that was a joke. forgive me.
No, forgive me.
No.
Apparently it was confusing.
I thought it was brilliant, but it took me a minute. And that's why it's brilliant.
Yeah. Little sleep. No, I just thank goodness for Josh and for whoever didn't have anything to do on my coverage. I asked them to yell, what do you yell? Shooting? Action, and cut. And
she's forgotten already.
I'm sorry.
And, like riding a bicycle.
Whatever the thing is the director does, I kind of did some of that at some point on this movie.
Go. I think I like the one where you say go.
Do it.
Yeah, and it was very, I sort of had all eyes on deck, and it was very helpful. What was your question?
Well, directing yourself as an actor is challenging, generally speaking.
Yes, you have to be in the moment, and so when you're looking at your scene partner and performing an action, then you do that. And then you always sort of, when it peters out, take a beat and yell, cut, and then sort of put on that director's hat. But I think it helps when you're super prepared. And again, I told someone this the other day that I wrote this first film very close to what I know, topics and for people that I know. So it wasn't a huge challenge to jump from job to job, if that makes sense.
And there were times too, just because we knew each other before and in an acting class, like, you know, as actors, we all have crutches. We all have things that we do that we know. And we also know how far we can go with things. And there would be moments where she said, what did you think about that after her performance? And it was like, I know you can go further, you know, and I've seen you do it. And I feel like you're holding back at this point. It's like, okay. And I think that's kind of part of the challenge of, you know, you're wearing that director's hat, you're wearing the writer, producer, you're thinking about the toilet paper and the bar that you got to go buy or whatever. And then all of a sudden you go, yeah, I need to bring it even more with the performance. And and she's able to rely on the other actors to kind of like check in with them and say, how are you feeling? How was I feeling? You know, this and that. And then just to get the performance up to where it needs to be and beyond. And I think that's really valuable. You know, the same thing kind of happened when you wrote the script. Like she said she, you know, sent it out to some people that she respects. But these aren't just people sitting around. These are like successful writers in Hollywood, you know, people who have stuff in production. And they're giving their notes. And to be able to use that as a resource was extremely valuable.
Mm. So did you ever have to walk over and whisper in her ear and say, you know, a little bigger.
You're indicating.
But to be honest, I welcome that. And that's not like a manipulated answer because I never once, because this is my first time doing so many, every job but the acting. Mm-hmm. So I never thought I knew more than I did. And I think that can be your greatest asset is to rely on other people, but also have confidence in yourself, which is sometimes I needed to do more, is just trust my own instincts and trust, you know, that we know how to do this.
Then the other side of it too is, you know, we're shooting digitally, so you can watch playback. Mm-hmm. If we were shooting on film, oh my gosh, you wouldn't be able to see anything for a while after the film gets developed and then let's go get the reshoots. Like, you know, it was it doing it digitally actually helps tremendously as well.
So that helped you? Did you watch yourself and judge yourself in that immediate?
I didn't have time to judge. I know it sounds weird, but really, if I had like sat back and thought, oh, I look terrible, or someone yesterday said how brave it was of me. A friend said, how brave it is that you weren't wearing any makeup. And I just didn't have time to care, to be honest. I just wanted to get the shot, look great, tell the story the best we could. And
so you were checking the picture to make sure it was in focus?
Exactly. But I will say we didn't have a lot of time to watch playback. So yeah. You really watch one, you get, you know, you shoot a couple to make sure you have safeties, and then you really have to move on. Mm-hmm. So again, it just comes back to focusing and trusting that the people you've asked to be in this and to contribute know their stuff. And I'm so thankful that I'm so proud of everyone's performance in it.
Yeah. Our DP, John Honore, was, you know, running the camera as well. So, mm-hmm. I mean, that's a great situation to have instantly. And he, you know, he's very creative. He knows he can take things a step further. He knows exactly what she wants and then can, is able to implement that and everything. So there wasn't a lot of like correction, you know, and I feel like a lot of times you don't have to correct a camera operator or whatever, but you know, with such a small budget and such a tight shooting schedule, to have everyone on the same page and clicking in at the same time is imperative. And so I think that's what we got with this film.
So was it 21 days? Did you actually have 21 days?
I think it was 24. Okay. It wasn't consecutive. Right. We'd shoot 6 days and have a day off. And then there were a couple of days where we only shot maybe four hours because we shot in a comedy club, and that's all the time they could give us and that we needed. But it was very, and I attribute that to just a lot of preparation and mapping it out and figuring, you know, here's when we have Josh and here's when we have these venues. And
I mean, look, doing The Walking Dead, we have a new director every episode, you know, and even though TV is a writer's medium, like the director still has a say in a lot of, you know, how it's mm-hmm. going to look. And you work with directors, and everybody's prepared, but you work with some directors who come in and they're just like, yeah, let's just see what, let's put it on its feet and we'll just kind of go from there. Then you come in with other people who know exactly what they want, they got it charted out. Mm-hmm. And for me, I appreciate that because I don't want to like sit around while they're still figuring it out, you know? Mm-hmm. That's where she sits. She's extremely prepared. She knows what she wants. She's not wasting anyone's time. She's going in and getting that. And then almost like editing on the fly as well. You know, I mean, you didn't edit this yourself, but you were there every step of the way when she was editing. So, but she already knew what she wanted beforehand. And that's really valuable in this situation.
So was somebody assembling it as you were shooting?
No, I did edit it myself.
Wait, I thought there was another editor.
Originally, we had another editor, but we had a deadline, which we wanted to do. Mm-hmm. We wrapped in the 24th of March, and our deadline was like August 15th for final cut, everything, colored, mm-hmm. everything. And this person didn't feel he could do that. So I actually went to the Apple store and educated myself on how to edit. And I'm quite proud of it.
So she wrote, directed, produced, starred in, edited, and bought toilet paper all for this movie.
She's the Jerry Lewis.
That's right.
Independent
film. French are going to love you.
French are going to love this movie.
Yeah.
It's going to be, you should be opening a can. I don't know why you're not there already. You could maybe director's Fortnite.
It's all, there you go.
You know, it's right ahead of us.
Yeah.
So you're in the midst. So as you're editing this movie, mm-hmm. were you surprised by that experience? Was that, I mean, that's a whole nother universe for a lot of directors.
It was the greatest experience. I had so much fun. And I had about, I don't even know, so I can't do the math, a little less than 6 months. I literally had someone help me learn Final Cut. I'd never edited before. My boyfriend's going to kill me because he's like, don't say that. But I loved it. And the only part I didn't like was the technical part. I mean, we shot on, you know, doing the red raw and compressing it. I still don't understand all that. But once I had everything in its place and in its mm-hmm. folder, I loved it. Because at the end of the day, I get off on the acting part and finding the moments and making everyone hopefully look great and no one have a false moment in any frame. And I mean, we're all human, and we, as actors, we all step out, and you mm-hmm. can see it. It's like the biggest red flag, and every single one of us was guilty of that. But you just, you know, film is manipulation, unlike theater. And at first, I thought it was cheating because I come from the school of you get on the stage and for the next 2 hours you are in it and you don't come out of it, and that is your job, and you tell the story from beginning to end. And in film, you're in it for a minute and then they all cut and then you go on your cell phone or whatever people do, mm-hmm. and it's so different. But it was fantastic putting this story together, and editing it was empowering and amazing. I loved it. I'm sorry. I'm such an editing geek.
Well, it's interesting because if people get, I mean, so you felt like you were able to find, that was your whole, that was your focus point, as opposed to shots or camera movement or whatever. You were just really trying to find the truthful moments in the acting.
Yeah, well, I didn't go to film school. So I went to NYU for acting, and I started acting when I was 8 on the theater. So that's what I knew. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't trying to pretend to be anything I wasn't. So I'm not going to get the David Fincher shot, but I...
Well, it's all a choice, ultimately. I mean, that's the thing. Right. It's like, there are editors who become directors, there are directors who, you know, there's all kinds of ways of going about it. But it's an interesting, you know, whoever's in the editing room brings a perspective.
Yeah.
And that does matter. I mean, the machinery of Hollywood so big is sometimes it overwhelms the creativity of a lot of editors, but...
And if you keep...
It's interesting perspective from you.
If you keep, like, 8 frames too long, you won't get the laugh. Or it won't be as funny. And learning all that was something I had no idea was so cool, because you just manipulate what you want your audience to hopefully feel.
Were there things you thought you had that you didn't get? Or things that you didn't realize you got?
Always. One of the last thing we shot on the 24th day was the very last thing in the film. And of course, and it was that magic hour time, and we had, you know, what, 30 minutes to get both of our coverage before this, we lost light. And he kept saying, like, open the iris more. Like, we did it to the last possible second, literally. And I would have loved to have even an hour more, but you just accept it and you don't try to fight it, and you just use what you have and you focus. And I was really lucky to have Josh, who was the consummate, he was such an asset, obviously. And, he was so focused, and we just knew what we had to do to get it done. So there's always stuff you wish you had, but I wasn't going to, I didn't have time or energy, even in editing, to sit back and pout and say, oh, I wish I had. You just have to make the film the best you can with what you've got.
Yeah.
It doesn't sound like any of this was hard for you. You were obviously working your ass off, but it sounds like this was a positive experience for you on pretty much every level through the whole process.
Well, I'm not going to lie. When you're in it, you think, why did I ever decide to do this? This is terrible.
I'm quitting Hollywood.
I'm quitting. I'm moving to an island somewhere far away. And I will never do this again, ever. But now that I have perspective, and actually it was a year ago we were shooting and in it, you know, time heals everything, or what is that saying?
Time heals all wounds.
Yeah. So I feel... Yeah, I'm inspired to keep going now.
And for you, is it, I mean, as an actor, is this a thing where you look at it and look at your own performance? Or is the experience of having done this with your friends and participating in something this intimate?
Yeah, I mean, I loved it. I love, you know, tackling new characters and doing things that I haven't done before. You know, when she came to me, like I said, you know, like she said, we were in an acting class before. She knows the things that I do. She knows what I'm capable of. And so when she crafted the character, it was something that she hadn't seen yet, but she knew that I could do that. And that's what I was initially drawn to, is like, I mean, the fact that my friend wants to put me in a movie, it's like, yeah, okay, great. But the character was great and the story was great. And that's kind of, you know, what I always look at when I'm looking to do a different project. You know, what is this for me? Like, am I going to have a good time doing it? And I, you know, definitely did with this.
I would say that when I met him, I didn't know much about him. And then when he shared his experience and what he had done and his background, really, or his success in Los Angeles, had come from sitcoms and that world. And I was astonished, because here I'd see him do these scenes in class and he was so compelling and so fantastic in the grounded work, which it didn't sound like he was going out for. So nothing could make me happier that this thing that kind of broke him through, or what do you say, is your thing that broke you, I'm sorry, very little sleep, but was this grounded work. And so I was so happy that I could write a part for him to do that. And then he found this on The Walking Dead because he's so fantastic in comedy as well, but heartbreaking in this grounded dramatic stuff as well.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah.
So was getting The Walking Dead gig and this character in particular surprising to you, given your more comedic history?
Well, for this character, it wasn't surprising,
right,
just because
fit,
you know,
right.
Obviously we every step of the way I was there, but it was very surprising for The Walking Dead for me, even though I knew I was capable of doing it. The whole time I was on another sitcom, and the whole time I was on that sitcom, I was in this class working on my dramatic side, and at one point when I felt like I was ready, I just called my agents and said, "Let's start sending me out for drama. I can do that." And The Walking Dead was the first thing they sent me out for, and that's what I booked. And so the fact that it was my favorite show in the world already, and then I booked it, I mean, yeah, that was very surprising. And then to play a character that's so different than other characters on TV right now is fun, and it's quirky, and it's, you know, I'm able to, you know, because I think I came on season 4, I shot that before we did Life in Color, so... I had like just a whole newfound perspective on my work and mm-hmm. and just the, you know, the whole process of putting anything together. And I think if I hadn't done The Walking Dead, you know, my performance in Life in Color probably wouldn't be where it is now. So I mean, it all helps each other, and it's pretty awesome.
Well, it's interesting timing because I think people will go to this movie at South By and expect the something from you that's similar to what they've seen. And then this is a different...
Expect a mulleted genius who's socially awkward?
Yes, but you're a mulleted clown is socially awkward.
Yeah, that's...
This is nothing like
your character. I got socially awkward on lockdown.
But this, I think, will be a surprise for a lot of, you know, the kids going to the movies at South By.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, new character for you, even though you've done things closer to this before Walking Dead.
Oh, sure. I think, you know, it's always fun for me when, you know, I get to meet the fans and stuff, and they get to see my personality, and they're like, "You're nothing like your character on the show," you know? But I'm nothing like any character. I don't think anyone has ever liked their character. I mean, maybe there's some similarities, but you're not like the character in the movie. I'm not like the character in the movie, but... We're actors. That's what we do, you know? So it's fun to see them and their reactions to seeing you on screen, and then to go and meet you and to have that reaction is always a lot of fun.
Though it's interesting because in a movie like this, oftentimes when you're these smaller films are more like the characters tend to be a little bit more like the actors mm-hmm. who do them. And in this one that doesn't, it feels like this was really, you both kind of went somewhere else.
Well, I mean, yeah, but I mean, there's similarities and everything, but neither one of us are, like, suffering great depression, you know, like the characters would be in the film.
I will say, Adam, who's in this, who, I mean, I know you said, he's so amazing.
He's great.
He's so amazing, but I knew him from NYU, and his cadence, everything about him is very similar to his character, except for the fact that he is the nicest person you will ever meet. And so I told Josh, I said, I know who I want to write this part for, and he's the perfect person to play it, because I feel like in Hollywood, they do these archetypal douchebag, you know, friends or ex-friends, mm-hmm. and they make it easy to hate, and they're not engaging or compelling. You don't want to watch them. You don't want to care about them. And how do you make someone whose job in the story is to service the antagonist, but how do you make him also compelling and you still care about him to some extent? And Adam was the perfect person for that because he is one of the best people I know. Mm-hmm. And so to have his cadence be similar and everything about him is that character, except for the fact that he's not ill-intentioned or ill-willed or anything. He's one of the most generous, amazing people.
Or maybe he is like that. He's just good at hiding it.
He's
don't know.
Really good at acting. But so, yeah. Anyway.
So you finish editing the film. You, I assume, make your own DCP at that point in your house. And you send it out. And so what's the day like when you get the acceptance at South By?
It was crazy. It was it was really surreal, and I'm really proud of the fact that I knew no one in the festival. We had no connections, and that's what I was the most excited about, is I got an email from the head saying that they were really seriously considering the film, And then, of course, you have to wait and wait, and then you get in, and then you can't tell anyone, which is also sort of, you've worked so hard, and you just want to be able to share it. But I did tell the story, and now it's in Huffington Post, that I ran into David Fincher at the restaurant we were eating, my boyfriend and I were eating to celebrate. And I waited for his friend to leave to go to the bathroom, and I just started talking to him because I was so excited. And our acting teacher actually knew him or knows him and is friends with him. So I said, you know, I'm not a crazy stalker. We have this person in common. And he was so nice. I've heard that he's, you know, people say he's standoffish and a jerk or whatever, but he wanted to shake my hand and congratulate me and ask me my name. And I was so excited.
There's nothing like meeting someone that you admire.
Yeah.
And realizing that in that moment they feel like you're their peer, you know, it's really special, and it's like those moments in Hollywood that you kind of live for and you wait for and you hope for, because there's, I mean, I'm sure 100 times a day people come up to him, yeah, I'm a director, and you know, they might be or whatever, but we got a film in South By and you did an amazing job with it, and you were sitting there talking with this celebrated director, this amazing director, and I know he viewed you as a peer, and that's awesome.
Yeah, well, I couldn't have, I need to go on record for saying that there were a million people who helped this project, and without any of them, people donating their homes to shoot in, people donating their time and for whatever aspect of, you know, contributing to the film. So this was not a one-man band or one-man show, you know? This, it couldn't have been done with all these people's help, without all these people's help,
yeah,
including this person.
So now you're a festival filmmaker. Are you hoping to go down there and get your next acting gig out of this? Or are you hoping to go down and expecting to make another film as a writer-director? Or what are you, where do you see yourself in next year?
Well, about halfway through this process, I mean, I set out to do the film just to get acting work. That was the goal. And then, and to have my friends be recognized for their talents as well. And then along the way, I sort of did develop this passion for storytelling, and I got this great idea that's tonally the antithesis of this film, and it has nothing to do with what I know, so it'll require research, but I'm very excited. So yes, I'd like
to
tell...
Were you a nanny at some point?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. No, legitimately. I mean, I wrote what I knew, and... That's what I knew.
Did you nanny in the East Coast or the West Coast?
I babysat on the East Coast, but I nannied out here.
What's the difference?
Babysitting is like weekend gigs occasionally when they're going out to dinner. Nannying is like a regular. You pick the kids up from school,
oh,
make
okay.
them dinner.
I get it.
Take them to gymnastics.
I don't like kids. No. I don't know these things.
And I'm guessing it wasn't a happy experience.
Nannying?
Yeah.
Well, I took artistic dramatic license, but definitely there are times when you're thinking, I don't want to be here. I don't care about your, you know, whatever drama is going on at school. And maybe that's terrible to say, but, you know, I had frustrations, definitely. But at the end of the day, yes, the people that I worked with and for are lovely and not at all. We shot in their home in Palm Springs, and they were very lovely.
And your boyfriend was a party clown before he became an agent? Is that the, or a development executive?
No, he's nothing. We put him in the comedy competition in the audience, but he's a behind-the-scenes person. He doesn't want any
He was not part of your inspiration for...
No. But I made him read the script like 65 times and give notes, so...
So you're off on a different journey than you really expected when you started this.
Yeah, I mean, I would love... Don't get me wrong, I would love to continue to act because that's... my first passion, but I'm fine creating my own work if that's what has to happen. I'm so used to it at this point that if the phone doesn't ring, I'll just keep doing my thing.
So you just want to be creating?
Yeah, telling stories, and telling stories that are not redundant. You see so much redundancy in coming out of Los Angeles and New York, and you want to have unique voices and fresh takes and different stories and social awareness. I'm sort of, yeah, I'd like that. Less violence and more social causes.
And have you found the community of independent filmmakers in LA? Or
I'm starting.
Do you feel like you're part of that group yet, or are you waiting for David Fincher to get you in.
No. And by the way, this film isn't like a... I'm not trying to liken myself to him. He's amazing.
David's never made anything that costs less than $1 million a second, so...
Yeah.
Did Fincher at least pick up your dinner?
No.
No. Ooh, okay.
We had our South by orientation in LA, and I met Hannah Fidel, and a lot of these cool, the director of the Manson Family Vacation, which I can't wait to see, mm-hmm. Jay Davis, I want to say. Really nice people. Everyone is so welcoming, and they don't care if you've never done this before or you've done it before. They're so nice, and we're all on Facebook friends now, and you know, some of them work on the show Togetherness, which I love, mm-hmm. and they're great.
You end up becoming part of an exclusive club that everyone's excited to be a part of, you know, as opposed to, oh, look at the new kids, and there's no, you know, there's nothing like that. It's like a community that's, you know, people are excited to be a part of.
Well, it does feel like that's changed in the last, you know, 5 years. The Duplassyization of Los Angeles, you know, it's like a different, there is this kind of encouragement of for actors to become directors and writers and... you know, even Steve Zissis on Togetherness has a more active role than just being an actor, and you know, he's part of one of the creators and everything. And those guys encourage it amongst their friends and their family and everything else, and it's kind of created an interesting. And the Austin group in general is kind of open, like Hannah.
Yeah.
So it's been kind of a nice change in the last 5 years or so.
And you know what's refreshing? They're really nice people. Mm-hmm. Now this could change in 6 months, but I find them to be very nice, and I love that because sometimes you get this, you experience an exchange. If you've never done something or you don't have an IMDb page, people can be sort of snotty to you, and I like meeting these people who are genuinely nice.
I think they're all about with the, you know, whatever makes the river rise lifts all boats.
Yes.
I think they all sincerely believe that, and they all work together in some cut, you know.
Yeah.
So there is that sense of everybody kind of being hands-on. And now you guys are part of that.
And exciting.
Yeah. And you can go kill some zombies.
Yay.
I bet you killed some zombies before you went to Atlanta, but that's a whole other conversation.
That's a different conversation,
an LA conversation. Thank you guys very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Yay.